G'day guys, Alan here. Welcome back to my workshop. Today I want to talk about parting blades. These guys. I have them in several sizes, 2, 3 and 4 millimeter thick blades. And they generally work pretty well. But I find that the 2 millimeter ones are quite fragile, in my hands at least. And they seem to lose the ability to hold the insert. The jaw opening gets out of shape or something. And in some cases, I have been clumsy and damaged it. Anyway, I've got a couple of these hanging around, which no longer work. So I thought I'd try and fix them, so I could get some more value out of them. So let's have a look, see how I went about it. So first step is to know your enemy. And so I started having a close look at the end of the parting blade to see how the inserts were actually held in. And there's a bit of variation, but anyway, the bottom line is the inserts are tapered and they've got a groove within on each side of the taper, which is used to align the bit into the slot. And you can see it's a pretty shallow V. As it turns out, that shallow V seems to be about 150 degrees, something along those lines anyway. But I wasn't sure whether the critical contact was the edges or in the centre. Because as you can see, looking at the holder, the centre is quite a clearly defined ridge. But I think that it's most important that the sides of the insert contact rather than the centre of the insert. So I took some careful measurements, sometimes using the precision pins and gauge blocks, other times using angle blocks. But using that information, I came up with a reasonably accurate picture of the blade. And use this to make a CAD model showing how I might actually make this thing. So, in figuring out how to remachine the end of this blade, it was important to understand whether the top edge was parallel to the bottom edge. I mean, it's easy to assume that it is, but... So we've got 31.41. So within the limits of accuracy of my measuring setup here, I'm going to say top and bottom edge are sufficiently parallel that I can assume it. So we're going to start by hacking the damaged end off, and it's convenient to use the parting tool blade holder from the lathe. Right, so we'll start the machining by cleaning up this, squaring up this end. Yeah, I think that'd be good enough. The little bit that hasn't quite cleaned up is going to get taken out with the pocket that I've got a machine anyway. Alright. Okay, so let's feed a bit more of the blade out, so I've got a bit of room to run the cutter into. So it seemed like a good idea to use the blade holder that fits in the tool post, and you'll see in a bit why it was particularly useful. But anyway, we'll have a bit of the blade sticking out. Yeah, I'm sure that'll be fine. Alright, just nip these up. Okay, with that chopped off and trimmed, my next thing is going to be to drill three holes. The two which go at the bottom of the insert socket, and the third one that's going to go there, mirroring this actually, and it's simply going to be an index hole. It's of an arbitrary diameter and at a known location. So I've already located this corner with the center finder, with the edge finder, sorry. So I'm going to put an index hole there, which I can measure from. Because I could use that corner, and will use that corner, to position these two holes. But to cut the sides of the socket, the lips I'm going to call them, I have to rotate this fixture on the rotary table. And then I'll lose this corner, with no real means of finding it again, because these will be at an angle. to the X and Y axis. So the index hole is going to let me sort that out. So three holes, one, two, three. And the location of the holes is quite important, so I'm actually going to use a center drill to get things started. And swap that out for the right size drills. Right, so we want a number 41 to get the 2.44. Okay, well that's my three holes. That's my index hole and the two holes at the bottom of the socket. And this index hole can start paying for itself because I'm going to take this out to deburr these holes. And then when I rotate this, this corner will be lost anyway, and I'll have to find the location, find the position of the thing again using that. So, okay, so I'm ready to start milling the pocket now, and I'll start by doing what I'm calling the lower lip, which will break into this the larger of the two holes, and what I'm calling the bottom. Now I'm going to rotate to remembering that my datum or x-axis is 182 degrees, so I've got to rotate to 166 with the rotary table. And I've done some testing and I found this thing is very impressively accurate. Provided you set it correctly, of course. Right, so that should be 166 degrees. Also, because of the size of the pocket, the biggest end mill I can use is 3 millimeters, and I've already noted that this is tough stuff, so that's a solid carbide end mill, which will hopefully be able to do the business. I can see I'll be able to track backwards and forwards with that. So now I've got to find this thing again, which means indexing on that hole. That's probably a bit better. Now, I'm going to do it just by feel to get this bottom piece lined with the top, just by feeling it. Now, it might sound a bit sketchy, but I actually did some tests with this, and it's quite remarkable how accurately you can do that just using the feel of your fingers. So the technique that seems to work best for me is to have a first pass, get it pretty close, zero the DRO, and then I can use the DRO to move away in different directions in 0.01 increments until I am satisfied that I've got the best I can get. So we can reposition now, moving away from that known index point. Okay, according to my calculations, now this thing has been rotated, the distance from the centre of my index hole to the centre of the hole that I want to break into is 12.29. This cutter is 3 mm diameter, so I've got to add 1.5 at least to that, which would take me to 13.79. But I'm actually going to go in at 14.3 to give myself some elbow room for my first cut. Also, I'm not sure whether to go full depth because of this material. I'd prefer to. Let's just see how it goes. I don't know what sort of speed to use for the cutter either, for that matter. It's carbide. It should be pretty tough. Might give it 1500 and see how that looks. Also, I better know when to stop. It'd be useful, wouldn't it? Cut a nice slot, that's good. Feels a bit funny when it was coming back out though. I don't really... Oh, probably because it was engaged on both sides of the slot. Right. So anyway, I can see that I can come in closer to the 14. If I come in at 14, I think now, get closer to, get within about 0.2 of the final result, and then I'll take a cut on the upper side, I think. Of course, I've got to find the hole again because I've rotated it. Right. Yes, that's what slows this whole process down. Every time you move, you've got to find the thing again. So that's located on the index hole again and reset the DRO to 0, 0. And go to 14.5, I think I said. So just repositioning myself here, if I go to the 14.5 I was talking about, then I'm past the side of the cut here, so I'll do a couple of slices, I think. Time for a bit of a look. So I knocked up a size gauge so I could check how it was going, and I know from trying it in another one that it goes a millimetre or so away from the back of the pocket. Anyway, you can see here I'm on the right track, but got to go in quite a bit further, which is good. I did one practice for this with a bit of scrap metal, and it's very easy to overshoot the size. Very easy. Because these angles are so shallow in relation to how much I'm skimming off, even a thousandth or a couple of thousandths can make quite a difference between where the insert sits in the socket. Well, I'll keep fiddling around until I'm satisfied with the fit, and then we'll have to change the setup to cut the chamfers. Okay, so I've shaved both sides of the socket, and I've come to the conclusion that I've gone deep enough. Although I won't know for sure until I start trying to fit the socket in, the insert in there. Anyway, I'm thinking that if I haven't got the socket quite wide enough, when I put the chamfers on, if necessary, I can just take a bit more off in the chamfering process. Which brings me to chamfering, which is actually going to be, I think, the trickiest part of this whole thing. When I first got started with this thing, I was planning on, at least had the option, of using the sine vise and jacking it up to 15 degrees to do the lips like that and leave the spindle vertical. And I did actually do one like that, and the angles came out about right, but it was a lot of messing about, and of course it might not be immediately obvious, but when you cock it up like that, suddenly the angle changes and it isn't a straight 15 degrees anymore. You have to calculate a compound angle, which I did, but anyway. But I've decided that there's a better option is to do it with the 15 degrees in the head of the milling machine using the nod. And the reason I think that's going to be the go is that it dawned on me that I've got basically got can have an axis of symmetry through here. So if I set it up to do the chamfer on there, I can whip the blade out and turn it round, which is the other reason why I use this, I can just turn it around and do the machining on this side, and my 15 degrees that I've got the nod set to will be correct without having to move or rotate the table. So I can do basically the top rebate on, say, that upper lip, this side, swing it around and do the underneath of that on this side over here. Anyway, that's my thinking. So what I think is going to be the issue, though, is working out how deep to go with the chamfer. I mean, the answer is, in theory, simple, to the centre line. Yeah, well, I'm not sure exactly how to do that. But what I think I'll try is take this over to the surface plate, blue this lip, and see if I can scribe any sort of a centre line on there to guide me. So let's give that a go. Okay, well, I don't know how well you'll be able to see, but I've blued the inside edge of the socket, and the height gauge here believes that the thing is 1.7 millimeters thick. Actually, it's slightly less than that according to the micrometer. It's 1.67, but I think there's a burr on the underside of this that I'm not too worried about, because what's 0.03 between friends? Anyway, what I'm hoping is that I'll be able to set this now at 0.85. Wind it the right way. And then hopefully manage to scribe a little bit on the centre line. I don't know how much optimism and wishful thinking that is, but we'll give it a try. Doesn't go all the way, so be it. But did we get anything? That's the key here. I don't know whether we've got anything. Not that I can see. Let's try again. How else might I do it? Just with a bit more force against it, maybe. Doesn't matter if I don't get a line the whole way. It'd just be nice to get a bit of a line. Oh yeah. The light's got to be in the right place. So I've got no way in hell of showing it to you guys. But there is a line there, a centre line on both sides. So it gives me something to shoot for anyway. I might put this under the microscope and you might have some sort of chance of seeing it. Or maybe it just catching it a little bit there. Not sure. Anyway, there's something for me to aim at. Okay, well, it's time to set the nod to 15 degrees. There is a scale on the side here, but it's terribly accurate. So it's not that critical in this case anyway, but I'll use the digital angle finder. Oh, put him there. Set him to zero. All right. And stick him here. Keep an eye on that. All right. And loosen these nod bolts. In case you haven't come across it, there is actually sort of like a screw thread cut in the back of this round bit here, and it works like sort of as you'd expect. To go up, you've got to go wind it up, I think you can probably see it starting to go. You won't be able to see that, but that's 15 degrees on the dot according to this, which I think will be close enough because, as I tried to explain before, once I start, I won't have to change the angle of the nod, so all of the angles will be, all the chamfers will be cut at the same angle, which is important for hitting the centre line, I think. Now, I don't know whether it's going to move when I tighten these bolts up, but I'm not particularly fussed if it does move a little bit. I should think it'll be tight enough. And what are we on? I think it has moved slightly. Yeah, it's claiming 15.05. Well, that's close enough for me. So, let's get set up down here. Right, getting set up to do the chamfers now, and I did a bit of a calculation before, but this is quite theoretical. But basically what it's saying is I'm going to have to feed the cutter in about 0.2, slightly over 0.2, for it to reach the centre line of this. Well, that's a bit theoretical. But the main thing is whether or not I can see that centre line that I scraped, because I really would like to use that as my guide. Well, I don't know how I'm going to go with that, but to get started, I'm going to, this is a 0.5 feeler gauge, and I'm going to set the cutter so it just nips the feeler gauge against the bottom corner of the lip there. And that'll give me a starting point. One advantage of this method, using the nod, is that I haven't had to change the angle of the thing here since I finished my trimming on this lower lip. All right, so I think I'll do a pass on that setting and see if I can detect any witness underneath here. See if I can see anything with my dentist's mirror. It's on a bicycle spoke. It keeps coming. It's just screwed onto the end of a bicycle spoke and it keeps coming loose. Do something better one day. Now, can I see anything here? Oh, I can. I can see that scribe line. Well, that's a bonus, and we're nowhere near it. Now, let's take another, go in another 0.1. I think I saw some chips then, so perhaps we've got something to see now. Oh yes, yeah, there's a witness line there now, a definite witness, and we're actually, it looks like it might almost be halfway to the centre. Let's see what we've got now. Try not to blind myself by shining my light in the mirror. That's actually looking pretty good. That's actually looking in pretty much exactly what I was looking for. So I think we'll take a bit off the other side now. Take a bit off the other side. And the beauty of this setup will become apparent now. Because of the symmetry around my zero axis, I can just take this, leave all this setup alone. Take the blade out and turn it around. And move over here. Make sure I'm clearing that. Yes, I am. Right, so let's clear that and come back here. You can see how I'll be cutting the other side of that lip now. Well, that looks very encouraging, so I'll have a go at chamfering the other lip now. So I crept up on the final size, but I'm happy now with the way the insert fits in this pocket. What I've got left to do is just clean the back of the pocket up and cut off this piece across the top here. A couple of pretty simple operations, so I'll just get that happening. And then we might go over to the microscope again and have a closer look inside the socket to see how that turned out. Okay, so I've reset the nod and trammed the mill again so that the spindle's perpendicular. And I now want to do the machining on the back of the socket. Now, there's not an awful lot of room in the corners here, so I've switched over to a 2mm end mill. I'm a bit nervous about that, I don't use them very often. I'll bump the speed up as well and just be a bit ginger with it. Well, I think that'll do. Just has to be enough room to get the little levery thing in there. So I actually think that I've done enough there. The angle of the back is certainly not critical. So we'll leave well alone with that and then get ready to cut this piece off. Ouch, that's sharp. Cut this bit off across the top. Go just a hair further, and I'll do it cutting from this end, I think. So I had to switch to a smaller diameter cutter to finish this off because I was running out of room back in the corner here. Yeah, go with that, that's good. All right, let's take it out, deburr it, and have a final look all round. All right, well, I'm very pleased with how that turned out. It's a little bit shorter than when it left the factory, but I think it should be just fine. So I'll take it over to the lathe and see if it actually works. Thank you. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that. You can't ask a parting blade to do any more than that. Okay, well that turned out to be probably easier than I was expecting. The hardest part for me was my eyesight's not that fantastic, so trying to home in on the that faint scribe line that I put in the middle of the lip was a bit of a challenge. But apart from that, it was a relatively simple thing. I just had to do a bit of a head scratch to start with to make sure I had a good setup that was going to work for me. But the end result was a good return for modest effort and encourages me to repair the other blades I've got in a similar way. Well, hopefully you found that interesting, maybe helpful to you. I mean, I can't imagine I'm the only one that's got these things and had this problem. But in any case, thanks for watching, and I look forward to seeing you on the next one.